towards something that's positive, something that's uplifting people, empowering people.
We have way too much fun. It's
I love you guys.
We love you too.
I really we love do. The crackers. Thank you for the crackers.
Yo, of so course. Amazing. I just grabbed the stack.
We need a cheese, olives.
Oh my God, a salami. Charcuterie.
Say it again.
Stop! Guys,
one time.
I took ESL. Okay? I took ESL.
In the Bronx.
Charcuterie.
All right. You know what?
But we know what the fuck she meant.
Yo,
you know what?
I can't take this.
Wait, hold on. Let me do the intro. Welcome back to another episode, of The Least Favored. This is a podcast where self-reflection meets accountability. I'm your girl, Natalie. And once again, we got the gang. We have Angel. We have Yaya. We have Fran Jez. Okay, what
are
we
going to
say about
yourself? We actually haven't left since the first episode. They have us hostage here.
Yeah, they've been hostage here the whole time.
We've been here for like 8 days straight.
Yeah, charcuterie. We should have had the charcuterie board next time. Next time, I'm going to bring one.
I said, how do you really say it?
Charcuterie.
Shit, that was funny.
You know what? It's all right.
I'm like a robot. I'm going to get crazy.
No, because you know what was one word that really humbled me? I used to say, it's an archive.
Yes.
That's the actual way. I used to say archive.
Oh, shit.
That's how it sounds like.
But I get where you come from with that one.
That's what
it's like. Spanish language.
Yeah, archive was number one. And number two, like the CH, it just messes you up. Sometimes it's cuz, sometimes it's chuh. Like,
no, right.
What do you want?
I always say, like, English is the dumbest language. Like, the way we, like, why is there a K before the N for knife? Like, why is there a K in lasagna? Like, I just don't get it.
Knife. Yo, I hate it. When I was a kid,
laugh, G-H at the end. Like, why is G-H a sound? I don't get it.
Poem is P-O-E-M, but home is also home. And but tomb is T-O. I don't get it.
Yeah, the M and the B. Like, that should be fucking me up.
The M and the B, the E-M.
And then they wonder why a lot of kids are coming and they can't
get
read.
It together.
It's like, it's
or people
difficult.
From other countries, like, what is this? ¿Qué es esto? And we don't know.
All right, so I want to start the episode. Okay, so something I keep seeing online, and I even went on a TikTok rant about this yesterday. I feel like people just be committed to, like, misunderstanding you sometimes because they really don't want... Committed to conflict, committed to misunderstanding you. I feel like when sometimes you ever had a friendship or even any type of situation with someone where you guys argue and you know your intentions, you know you just want to speak, like, talk it out. They bring up the conversation. You say your side, but you're coming at it with love. Like, I think about you, right? Like, come at it with love. Don't be negative. So you're actually committed to the resolution. But they just keep on bringing up what you did, how you made them feel, pointing the finger, not taking accountability for their actions. So it's like, did you want to resolve this? Because you came to me with the situation. Did you want to fix this? Or did you want to just continue the argument?
I don't understand those people. I try.
Cut them off.
No, I think those people, they just want to hear themselves speak.
It's crazy. But then I think, like, if you really know some of the people that I'm, like, thinking of now that I've gone through this with, they are, like, hurt. Like, they've gone through some shit. Mm-hmm. And they are dealing with their own shit. So it's like, that makes it easier for me to disengage because it's like, I can't take this personally. You're just hurt. Going through your shit and you're projecting that. You just need an outlet. You need a punching bag.
This is a perfect segue.
I know. I'm poetic. So this is where I got the question, like, hurt people. Well, not, it's a statement. Hurt people hurt people. But we know that. People have been saying that for years. But it never clicked until now that I'm older and I've been in therapy. And so, but I want to also take accountability for the times that I've hurt people because I was hurt. And I want to know if you guys, like, have gone through this. Do you see where I'm going?
This is a podcast where we take accountability.
I thought I was in therapy. I thought it was 5:00 again today.
I thought I was somewhere else. Me and Fred just thought we were at a bar.
Do you still feel like you're a victim to that?
Yes.
I told you what I said.
Wait, about what?
I got hurt, and then I hurt people, and then I hurt people that I shouldn't have hurt. And then I got hurt, mad hurt.
A lot of hurt.
I got a lot of hurt back.
A lot of pain.
I took the pain. I gave it away. I took it back. Then I gave it back to the pain.
I bet you could do it. It's a lot of pain.
No, y'all got me shuffling it up too. So yeah.
It's all that pain.
It's true.
Londoña has been hurt.
And then, like, also, then I thought of you because I'm like, you don't want a date, but it's more so like a perfection thing. You want people to be perfect. But do you also feel like it's because of, like, you're going through something,
so glad
or
this came back
you don't
up
want
wanted...
to, like, hurt other people because of the ways you've been hurt? Like, what is that about? Is it deeper?
I think it's trust issues. Mm-hmm. And of course, I've been hurt, cheated on, all that type of stuff. Physically hurt, all that.
Oh, wow.
All that type of stuff. So I know the worst case scenario. I know the possibilities. I know how fake people are. I know motives, ulterior motives, all that. That all turns me off. Mm. I feel like maybe it'll happen one day, but I don't care if it does. I prefer not to. I don't want to be that vulnerable. I don't even want to allow somebody to even possibly hurt me.
Yeah.
All that shit. Yeah. So I guess it is my past. Yeah.
Yeah. Have you hurt people? It's not just for him.
Absolutely.
Like, first, he just took me for a ride because I'm with you, brother. I promise.
Talk about it.
That was. Yes, I have hurt somebody actually.
You guys make me. That hit my heart.
A sooner, yeah, no,
I actually forgot.
Yo, I was like, he gets. Is he God? I don't know. He gets, is he reading my thoughts? No. Unfortunately, I do agree that hurt people. Oftentimes, I don't even think it's willingly or consciously. Like sometimes, I feel like the majority of the times it happens, and you don't intend for that.
Want to hear some deep shit?
Go ahead.
I just had this conversation with my brother. And I told him how what we went through is why we are the way we are. It's not your fault you are the way you are. My brother has a lot of demons. I used to. I'm growing out of it. And I had to bring it to his attention. He's older than me, but I've just been, you know, really working on self-help more than him. So I told him, it's not your fault. It's not our father's fault. Our father didn't have a father. He didn't have a father figure. He didn't know how to be the ideal father to raise two amazing men. Mm-hmm. So when I read that hurt people, that's what I thought of automatically. Mm-hmm. I was like, wow, that's a different, when I thought of it, I was like, that's actually a different twist on it. Because we're probably thinking relationship-wise. Mm-hmm. But it's deeper than that.
Deeper. No, it's in general, overall. That reminds me of another quote that you just stated because of your father. Like, it isn't your fault. What is occurring to you isn't your fault, but it is your responsibility to fix that and make sure you don't hurt anybody else. You know what I mean? Because it's so easy to, like, the easiest thing I think has happened, and again, I think I learned this at a young age, like, somebody does you wrong or somebody hurts you, it's super simple to go to the obvious. Fuck you, I hate you, you're bad, you're evil, you're all this. Sometimes, bro, sometimes good people hurt people too. Sometimes good people make mistakes. Sometimes it's a lot deeper. Sometimes bad people also don't intend to do certain things a certain way and to that way. Like, there's so much that goes into it, which frustrates you even more, actually, because when you say, oh, I hate you, you're a bad person, you're a bad girl, you're a bad friend, whatever the case is, it's easy because you can just leave that. You're like, you're bad and that's good. I'm living fine. It's harder to kind of think like maybe this person was hurt before and that's why they're hurting us. That sucks more because now you're still hurt. Then you're literally like empathizing with who hurt
or
you.
Or maybe I actually was an asshole and did some shit to make them hurt me.
It also happens. It you also that's I mean? Also the fact.
That's also
but
too.
That's more taking that accountability and realizing like maybe somebody's hurting me because I hurt them.
Right.
Which is also difficult to do. All of this stuff is hard and people don't acknowledge that as much, I guess. Like, that's what we speak about often here is just try to treat everything with kindness, even when it hurts the most. I think that's when you need to deal with it the most kindly.
Yeah, but that's why I thought of like franchise when I was thinking of this too. Like, when you finally do have that conversation, if you could at least acknowledge, yo, you know what? I get why you were a dick because I did some fuck shit too, but you're still committed to resolving it.
Yeah.
And so that's the difference too. Like, both people have to be committed to the resolution. 100%. Because otherwise, I'm trying to fix it and you're trying to keep adding on and breaking it down. And it's like,
it's over.
We're not going anywhere.
Sometimes people literally like to argue to argue.
They just like to argue. Mm-hmm. It's like, what?
There's nothing, there's no substance behind what they're arguing about. Like, often, like, again, I don't mind any, I gotta have a thousand of the same conversations as long as every time there is some progression or we're trying to reach a productive end to it. But if I get the gist that you're just like, you just want to be right, or you just want
to I was waiting to get like, a pause to say, because you just want to be right.
Then there's no point. I really
people like
don't,
that are pointless
don't care
to argue,
right?
Yeah.
So for any wrong person like that.
Like, the point is learning. Yo, I could be wrong as fuck, but if I learn from that experience and we're able to move forward productively, meaning either we don't talk, but there's no beef, or we actually have a stronger relationship than when we went in, I think that's a win.
I don't care if we got beef or not. I'm just cutting you off.
You could be like, oh, you're cut off, and that's, you know, that's that. Right. But sometimes you could just distance from each other in a healthy manner where it's like, there's no beef, but I don't fuck with you.
I prefer that.
Ideally, you know, if you really can.
Obviously, I'm not beefing with nobody. Like, yeah, I'm good. People may have an issue with me, but like, we're great. Because if I see you, I'm not going to do anything. I'm not going to be malicious. I just want to acknowledge you.
Times they're weird. People usually who have beef with people like that, or like how you're saying, they just have beef. It's like an internal thing. Yeah, you got beef with yourself.
You got beef with you. You don't like you. You don't like you, and it shows. That's really what it is. Wow,
damn, she's the one.
It shows. She's right. She's right. Like, fuck it. It is what it is.
So everybody that you've ever had beef with, or whatever the case, you can walk into a room right now with them and you're okay?
I'm great.
Anybody?
I'm comfy.
There's a couple people. I don't know what's going to happen.
I can think of one or two.
I don't know what's going to happen.
No, maybe I'm wrong. I'm probably going to get shot. I have no idea.
Could you imagine, like, everything's sweet and somebody's just tackling and nagging what the fuck?
They throw a Henny bottle at me. Like, what did you do?
This bitch is
smart. A Henny bottle. Now you know where we spend most of our time.
This bitch smiling.
No, I don't know. Like, Natalie, what did you do? But you know what it is? Because as quickly as I can be upset at something, I get over it just as quickly.
Me too.
And especially if we were cool, we had any type of friendship, or if I ever had love for you, I can't hate you.
I hate that shit. I want to be mad sometimes.
I want to be mad. Yo. I want to hate you forever, so like, fuck it.
It's been like 2 days, whatever.
Whatever. Then don't fuck with me, then whatever. It's all love. We good. Fuck it. It's fine. Okay, so I want to get into, one of the books that I was reading, is called 100 Essays to Change the Way You Think by Breonna West. Amazing book. I recommend to all. So there was something that she said that people have these three habits, and I want to see if you guys resonate with it. So I'm just going to read like a little short part of it. She said, one of the first habits we have is that we make problems where there are none, as though for our lives to have meaning, we need to overcome something. Happiness is something that we have to consciously choose. Otherwise, we'd create the reality that we subconsciously think we deserve. So I wanted to know if you guys agree with that.
100%.
Okay. And then do you feel like you find yourself creating problems in your life subconsciously?
Mm-hmm. Every day.
Oh.
Talk about it.
Every day.
Yeah, no, yeah, every day. Oh. So that escalated.
About battling demons. Like, oh, shit.
No, so one thing.
On a daily. She's fighting for her life.
The wake up.
Literally.
No, so one thing that I really deal with is paranoia. Mm. Remember, I think I came to one episode and I felt like a guy was fucking following me here. But it was literally in my head. Mm. Since I've been going to therapy, it's gotten a lot better. But one thing that I've learn that it can be coming from my past trauma. And one thing I try to do is address myself like, this was your past. This has nothing to do with you now. You need to forgive yourself for what happened. Oh. And it just like an overall of like what happened with my past, like how I used to be, people I used to hang out with.
Oh, okay. But I still, because I was going to ask, did you want to talk about what you remember?
Yeah, like I just used to hang up around a bunch of gang members. So it was always something like shootouts, people doing shit, pulling up on blocks. I had a thing with tinted cars like earlier this year. Anytime I see a tinted car, I was freaking out. And I'm thinking somebody's going to do something to me. But then like reality of it was like, girl, you're not that important. And I never did anything to anyone. Like, I really had to talk to myself.
It's
like,
the man. They're always after me.
Yo, yeah. And I'm like, I was like, did I ever kill someone? Did I ever do something? And then it's like, no, bitch, you bugging out. Like, you need to relax. So now I try to wake up every single day, do what I have to do for my daughter, go to work. And I tell myself when I'm walking to work, I'm like, from after parking my car, I'm like, yo, you deserve a soft life. You don't need to be looking over your shoulder. Like, who the fuck is going to do something? Nobody's going to do nothing to you. If they wanted to do, so if somebody was going to do something, they would have done it by now. That's what my therapist told me. She was like, you need to be in tune with yourself. What is it that's going on with you? So that shit, like, even today, I'm not going to lie, parking my car, I'm looking, there's a car pull up. I just be mad vigilant, like aware, but I stopped being so hyper vigilant because I'm like, I'm not going to be able to have fun or be myself or even protect my daughter if I'm looking all over the places all the time.
Right.
So.
But isn't that your occupation in the military?
Yeah.
So then you're done.
But I work in an office.
Sorry to say like that, but you're gonna.
No, she works in a. Yeah, I work in an office. So,
but that's what the whole mentality is to always be alert for the worst case scenario.
My therapist did say that that hinders something.
He meant you're done in a good way. Like you,
no,
you
but
got it down back.
No, it's a bad way.
Oh, I try to.
where the whole mentality is survival and worst case scenario.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
While you're working there, that's the mentality.
That's
when
true.
You put that uniform on, you're thinking worst case scenario.
Yeah.
But then at the office, Lonnie's over here wilding. Got the keyboard.
You imagine.
Like, you know, I think your professions clash.
So what did your therapist say about that? Because now I'm curious. Because she knows what you do.
Yeah, she knows what I do. So she said that I have to learn how to differentiate the two. One thing that she told me that's very important, she's like, I need to learn how to differentiate an immediate threat rather than something that's in my head.
Please do.
So, okay. No, I've been learning it because it would be like anyone I see moving suspicious, I'd be like, nah, this person's onto something. Like, what's going on? Now I'm looking. Now I'm wasting my whole time looking. In the gym, it happened to me. And the last time it happened to me in the gym, I had to snap out of it. I'm like, girl, like, you're working out. Just relax. Because sometimes I talk to myself, it's like, you're really bugging right now. Like, people come to the gym to just work out.
Yeah.
And you being a weirdo staring at the person because...
About to drop that dog doing curls. Like,
I feel like I'm the opposite. I'm not aware of my surroundings at all.
Nah.
So I feel like you always bubbly. You're like, I'm the queen of the world. Nothing's going to happen to me.
I'm like, the world is my runway. Everyone loves me. I am a star. If anything, I feel like there's paparazzi around me.
She made us ask. She asked us to laugh.
No, but it's true. Like, I really feel like I should work. I've been like, my mother used to tell me that all the time. Like, what? Like, wake up. Like, you're not alert. Like, you don't know what the fuck is going on. I've gotten better, but I'm like, damn, I wonder what it would be like.
She'd be driving and forget she's driving.
Oh, shit.
You have me down. Like, dead ass. That's what it is. I just like live my life and I'm enjoying myself. Oh, God, I don't want to talk about that.
But I do. No, I'm kidding.
But anyway, yeah. Wait, what were we talking about?
Are we doing the bowl?
No,
or
it was on the next one.
No, we're just moving on. Okay. We're not doing the bowl today.
Yeah, she's in charge.
All right, so we're gonna do the next one. Can you recall a specific instance where you felt conditioned by others' opinions about you?
Oof.
And did it affect your self perception?
Yep.
All the time.
Absolutely, yeah.
Do we all, are we, okay, where are you guys at with like, oh, I don't care what people think of me.
I truly don't give a fuck. Honestly, I don't give a fuck. But when certain people, when you're in a certain role and you're doing certain things and somebody says something to you, it can trigger you in a certain way and have you start thinking about yourself. And it's like, wait, am I doing this? Am I acting this way? Like, am I not good enough?
What
am
kind
I not
of role proficient? You mean? Like at work?
For me, and at work, okay. Yeah. Being in the military, mm-hmm. like I'm a staff sergeant now, mm-hmm. so I got promoted. One of my friends, he's like, oh, you know, like you too nice as a sergeant. And I'm like, the fuck you want me to be? Like, it's modern day army. I'm going to still treat my soldiers as I should. But he's like, you need to learn how to differentiate the two. So now I'm aware at work where I'm like, oh, should I not talk to my soldiers anymore? Should I not conversate with them? And it's like, nah, like I could still be myself. Just understand the boundaries and just not ever let anyone cross them. Not that they ever did. But in my head, you know, I'm seeing it a different way. Right. So, sorry.
No. I guess that does take a different. I can see that. And not taking it too personally. I think I'm somewhere down the middle. Like, nobody really cares. Everybody's, I don't care. But everybody cares.
It's, we don't care.
Even if it's about specific people. Like, if you respect those people or you care for those people, you be caring. I know because, like, there were times where it's like, and I mean to bring it up only because we were discussing this the last time, but it's right, I'm a man, so there are standards already. So at some points, not always. Typically, I think I'm very confident and very sure of myself. But whenever I check in, I definitely do think like, damn, am I doing good enough as a man, as a son, as a brother, mm-hmm. as a friend? All of that does come to mind at some point. And sometimes things people say definitely bring it up. Mm-hmm. If it is those people that I respect or care for or the people that I'm supposed to be that. Like if I have a friend say something kind of questionable, I'm like, about me or my friendship, not saying that it has happened, but it's an example. I definitely do think about it when I'm on my own and I'm like, damn, did I do good? Did I not? Whatever the case, usually I come to a resolution or a resolve. And I'm like, all right, maybe I was chilling, maybe we were tripping or something. Maybe I do need to work on that or whatever.
Oh my God, yeah.
But yes, I do definitely spend a lot of time in my own head thinking about that.
But I think you have to be, sometimes you have to get like really in tune with yourself
mm-hmm.
and ask yourself like, am I really this person? Because somebody at work tried to tell me, like, you know when someone says something to you and it doesn't hit you at the moment, it hits you after?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Somebody at work told me that she was going to mold me. And I didn't, at the minute, like, you know when you're, like, focused? I was mad at other shit that was going on that day.
I would have took such offense.
No, but I didn't, like, I didn't react to it. Then when I got home, I'm thinking about that shit. I'm like, I wasn't thinking, like, how is she think? Like, I was thinking, why did she think that? So it made me question my personality. Like, girl, you think I, like, I come to work to be playing? Like, so I'm like, she's looking at me a different way. Then I had to come to terms with reality. She's nowhere near half the person that I am.
Oh, damn.
So I'm like, I'm not even going to take that into consideration. But it bothered me because she said it. And I'm like, it had me questioning myself. I questioned myself for 2 days.
Yeah, we're humble as ever here. I'm going
to say, like, before I say what I'm about to say, I want to know from you. Because you're very, you seem very confident and very like, this is who I am. Fuck off type shit.
Yeah.
So like, what do you think about this?
All right. So the only people that I really care how they view me is my mom and my daughter, really.
Fair.
Of course, the rest of my family, of course, I don't want, you know, because that's why I kind of limit what I say on camera. I don't really talk too much sexually because it's, you know, I have a teen daughter. So I try not to get too specific with certain topics. So that's mainly my limits, my mom and my daughter. Besides that, I don't care what anybody thinks, right. 100%.
Wait, so you have your, like, your people who you care for. It's like...
Yeah, family.
And to some degree, I know that if, like, your mom is, like, being outrageous with something, you're kind of like, ma, you're misunderstanding that. I'm not that way. I know that you're probably be like that.
For you, it's more respect thing.
Yeah, it's more out of respect.
100%
yeah,
respect.
Yeah, it's respect. Yeah. So what I was going to say about this is I just think that, like you said, being in tune with yourself and also having confidence in, like, who you are and what you bring, but also knowing where you lack and owning your weaknesses. Because nobody can use your weaknesses against you if you own up to it.
Yeah.
So, but that was hard for me. When I was younger, oh my God, yo, every little thing somebody said negative or any critique, I used to take it to heart. I'm crying.
Because you were a princess.
Because I was that. And then it's like, exactly. But because I was raised like, oh, you're so special. You're this, you're that. It's like,
you're like, bitch,
how dare you? Like, I suck as a human being. What the fuck? But you now, you get to a point where now I still have confidence in who I am. I think I'm the shit.
Also,
it's like, I even own when I don't know some shit or I've been a shitty friend. I've been a shitty partner. And the only thing is that you know that you're capable of making it better. That's it. Like, the same way you can have that confidence and know you're the shit, you can also own your weaknesses and be like, okay, maybe I'm not good at that. I could either get someone to handle it or I can learn and I know I got it.
But you know, that in its own, I consider confidence.
That's it. Exactly.
You're brave as fucking, you're dope. That's dope. That's the dopest thing. I prefer a person who's always like, hey, I'm good at this, but I'm bad at this.
Mm-hmm.
That says a lot more to me than you're like, I heard one guy once I used to work with years ago. The boss was telling him something about something and I don't know if it was because she was a woman. I don't know. But he was like, oh, I don't make any mistakes. And she's like, I'm telling you. And they were chill. They were cool enough. She's like, you did this wrong. He's like, I don't make mistakes. I said, kept my mouth to myself. But in my head, I'm like, you're bugging. You don't make mistakes.
And that's annoying.
That's a brave ass statement to make as a human being. You don't make mistakes at all. You couldn't even fathom. You couldn't even be like, usually I'm good at this. Usually.
You don't know.
He's like,
nah,
I don't. Yeah. He's like, nope. Mm-hmm. Mistake. Your mistake was thinking I'm going to make a mistake. I'm like, all right, cool.
Yeah.
But if you own up to those stuff, I have a lot more respect for you if you're a person who owns up to their weaknesses as opposed to you being a person who claims to have none.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
My opinion.
Okay, so the next...
Oh my God, where'd she go?
Dude. Oh, yes!
Who?
Look at me ready to dive in.
Apparently you were speaking too much about her profession and the military took her
out. Right? Guys, Yaya... she had to go somewhere. Thank you for coming, Yaya.
That was very vague.
We didn't kill her. No, she has somewhere to be. So we're going to just continue the rest of the episode without her. But thank you for coming, Yaya. You're hilarious.
You will be missed.
Where did she go?
I watched a lot of Nickelodeon coming up.
We heard.
Yeah, right.
Back in the 70s, right?
Stop.
For those of you who don't keep up with us, right. I make fun of Frances's age.
It's been like 3 Frances episodes. Frances is one of the older people. Came at me.
One of the more ripe. Seasoned, if you may.
Seasoned. I like seasoned.
Seasoned is good. No, you were very wise.
Thank you.
No. He got me. Did I? What other shape should I have?
Nothing. No hands.
I pray to God. He's not gonna edit this out. He's not gonna edit this out. This is a behind the scenes moment. Not. You know what I said? What I said? I'm gonna stand on
right, like
stand on business. It was one. It was more upward than side. That would have been weird. You know what? He's right. Damn it! I said season after. Nobody said shit about that. We gotta cut this down.
Just stop. You're making it worse. All right. So getting back to the book, the third habit that you said that we have is that we summarize in our heads. So whenever we're about to make a choice about anything, we say in our heads what that choice will sound like. So quote unquote, she graduated and started this job at 20. It's as though our decisions can only be acceptable if they sound right, and how they will continue sounding years later. Do you feel like you've ever made a decision based on how it would sound to other people?
Yes. I can't think of one, but absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
See, now I'm having a hard time seeing if I've actually done that.
You know, back to earlier where I was saying how I'm a certain way because of my family and all that. So just because of that alone, I could see certain things. Yeah.
Okay.
Just because of tradition.
Yeah, it could be that simple. Not necessarily something that you completely, you know.
Because I feel like my life choices, maybe like my family influenced it. And maybe I was, because it was either like I would go back to school and get my degree, or I was just going to stay like a Costco like supervisor. Mm-hmm. And to me, that just didn't sound right. Like saying, oh, Costco supervisor, like that's going to be my career. That's going to be what I say when I'm 40 and 50. Like, I just didn't feel okay with that. So I think to some extent, yeah, I cared. But I don't know if it's because maybe it was both. I cared how it sounded, and I also cared how people around me were viewing me. So maybe it was both. Yeah.
Not to bring it up again, but I regret that stupid bonk shit, bro. I going back to high school, I would actually eat the fucking lunch. I would say, fuck all y'all with that dumb bonk shit.
Wait, what?
Bonk.
Hold on. What's,
y'all remember the bonk?
Oh, okay.
In Yonkers, the school lunch, you were whack if you ate the school lunch.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so nobody ate the school lunch.
You were whack
and,
if you
and
school?
That was the thing. Like,
fuck in, you guys.
So then what were they eating? They were buying shit outside?
Going by and waste money. Waste money to go fucking. And it was free food. Yo, that's one thing I would go back and change. So yeah, those motherfuckers.
You want to eat the school lunch?
Go back to Little Francesca and be like, eat the fucking.
Yes. I'd be like, well, my man, nobody gives a fuck. Never.
Oh, I always
stupid
ate
shit.
Eat the goddamn chicken sandwich.
Why?
It was so stupid.
That was wild.
Because it was free.
Be like, it had to be like a Yonkers thing. I don't know. Or something that they did like back
that's
in the 80s
crazy,
or something. I don't know.
People are dumb.
I regret that.
So you were saving, you were spending
I would
money.
Go back and eat that pizza. I would eat all that.
You know what? That stuff wasn't as bad as people made it seem.
I love food. I just, I regret letting all that food up.
Yeah, but no, I don't think, maybe it was the Yonkers thing. I was in the Heights, so I never.
Yeah, I've heard it in the Yonkers mainly.
Yeah. You said bonk, and I was like, were they hitting you? I don't know. But that sounds fucking whack. And then when you
agree.
That's one of those things where when you grow up, you're kind of like, damn, I did that.
I hate it. I hate that.
Like, I regretted definitely sagging my pants to like fit in. And I realized this like a year or two later. I was literally peeing. I'm in the bathroom, dude. I'm like 12. And I'm like, when I went to put on my pants, I go, why? And literally just put it up that day. And since that day, I never sagged again. Literally, I was literally just, and I'm like, I went to put it up where they belonged, mm-hmm. where I'm sagging. And I'm like, yo, this is kind of whack. And I had like 2 years already doing it. And I'm just kind of like, all right, after that day, I just never did it again. Cause I'm like, it's kind of weird. I don't really fuck with this. And I stopped doing it.
I think that'd be the thing too. Like when you ask yourself, but why?
Yeah.
If you really don't have an answer, it's like, well, then it doesn't matter. I really have no answer.
Or if your answer is to your standards, a stupid ass answer, then you just shouldn't do it. Does it make you feel good? Mm-hmm. Are you doing it for you?
Right.
Is it right to you?
Right. You're not compromising your morals.
You shouldn't compromise. Which people do. We're not necessarily to those extremes, but sometimes people do compromise their morals.
Sack like, and jeans, you're literally just showing your ass.
Have you ever made fun of?
You're a man you showing whore. Your ass in public.
Did you ever make fun of somebody for eating the school lunch if they did?
I don't think, you know what? I was a weird type of kid. I was cool with everybody. I was cool with even the special ed kids.
Yeah.
So I don't really make fun of people like that. And if I did, I made fun of people that I knew like in a fun,
Right,
way.
Right.
I was never maliciously trying to like hurt nobody. Good, so yeah, nah, I never made fun of nobody like that. I fuck with everybody though.
I can tell.
You're a bad man.
You terrible human being. That's our producer, by the way.
I love people. He makes us look good. People,
why?
Too bad he's a shitty person.
I don't even know.
It was.
I wonder if it's still like that now.
My daughter goes to Yonkers.
Just smiling.
I gotta ask her.
Ask her, yeah.
I gotta ask her.
That'll be good. All right, so the last habit, actually, no, she gives us a takeaway. So she says, life has no plot other than the one we're living in the moment here and now. We often choose our current experiences based on old beliefs we are still holding of ourselves. Do you feel like you're still carrying old beliefs about yourself?
Yeah, we definitely are. I can't pinpoint one specifically, but generally I'm going to say 100% because are who we literally from childhood till now, we're that same one person. You know, society makes us think after this age, after grade school, after high school, after puberty,
like your essence is still intact.
Different people, you're growing. We're changing in a sense where we're maturing because life is hitting us and we have responsibilities, but we're the same exact people.
I agree.
So everything that bothered us as a kid, not everything, but a lot of things that bothered us as a kid still bothers us now.
And even some traits we had. I agree
with that
100%.
That's why we remain triggered. We still get triggered by things. Yeah. It's
like your essence doesn't change. Like to the core, you're the same person. I agree with that. Like you can mature, you can be more wise, you gain knowledge and you can change or get even worse. But like your essence still, that's why like if you were kind as a kid and you're still kind now, like that didn't change. You know what I mean?
Right.
You have certain traits that never change. So I can get behind that. I always agree with that.
Do you feel like there's, if we're talking about like your essence, is there a part of your personality that you do want to kind of abolish completely?
Wow.
Like get rid of it. Be good or bad, I don't know. Like, you know how you said maybe you don't want to get rid of this, but like an example would be like you feel like people say you're too nice.
I was just about to say that. Sometimes
I get that too sometimes.
Sometimes I do. Like sometimes I'm like there's points where you're kind of like, damn, would it be easier? Because I see other people who are not as nice and they be chilling. But then I hear how people like I was thinking about this in the shower early this morning, actually. Not that, Frances. I was like, yo, why do people always cling on to the negative shit but never the positive? In a sense where, like, somebody says something negative to you and, like, you let that eat you away. You know what I mean? Like, you're like, damn, this person think... And even if you don't, you're kind of like, oh, fuck this person because they said something negative. But you never, like, we tend not to, not never, but you don't tend to cling on to the person who says something positive about you or you affect it positively. Like you go, yo, why does this person think I'm a jerk? Like, what the fuck? But do you ever think like, damn, why does this person think I'm a good person? Like, do you ever cling on to that and feed into that version and that point of that negativity? So whenever So whenever I think like, oh, maybe sometimes, damn, am I too nice? Maybe I'd like to get rid of that. I think about every person who I positively affected or how good I felt when I helped those people or I was that nice or I am that person and somebody comes from years later like, yo, don't change. And I'm like, fuck that, man. I'm good. I'm good with that. At least.
You know what you made me think of? You made me think of like it's a ego thing. I think our ego naturally just is like, you think I'm a good person? Of course you do. Like you don't even think about it. Cause it's like, of course you think I'm great. I'm awesome. But so like that kind of like brushes off your shoulder. But now that bruised ego, when someone says something negative about you, it's like, how could they say that? Like, what is it about me? And am I stupid? Am I ugly? Am I this? Am I that? And like you hamper on that shit because you can't take it.
Damn, you're. Like, I'm gonna ask for
no, it. Because the ego is some real shit.
I've been
that
trying to kill
it
for many years. That's why I stopped. Whenever I think of like whatever somebody does to me or however somebody speaks of me, that's a reflection of what they believe and how they are. Mm-hmm. But that's why I'm extra grateful for the good stuff. Because that's why, remember you asked about Jar and I was explaining about him. You're like, damn, what are you love with this guy? It's just like when you meet
shout people, out to Jar.
Yeah, shout out to Jar for sure. God be done. The thing is when you meet people who like show you, who like reflect similar things to you, he's going to make me laugh again. Like, that's a dope feeling. So I brought him up in particular because we spoke about him. But when I meet people like that, dude, I cling on to them and I remember them. Whenever I see them, it's always all love. And we barely have to speak, dude. I can see a person once a year. But every time I see them, if it's with a lot of love and it feels authentic and it's all genuine, right. I never let go of those people. It's the negative people that I'm kind of like, you feel that way? I literally wish you peace.
Right.
I don't wish anyone harm has ever done me negative or anything wrong or anything like that. I truly wish that they're comfortable with what they did, or at least they get to a point where they are, and I wish them peace. So I started seeing things like that. Like I take the negative. You have to reflect on both always. Why is this person saying this? How deeply would you let it affect you? And what are you going to do about it if you don't like what they said or you do like what they said? So this person thinks you're kind. Okay, so I'm going to keep being kind and I'm going to keep being me. If that's really me.
Yeah. Oh,
this person said I'm a dick. Think of that. Was I being a dick to that person? If you don't think you were, then don't worry about it. Then maybe they're going through some shit. But maybe you might have said, damn,
maybe,
I did say something that came off wrong.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
It's and all, also, it's maybe you were a dick and you don't give a fuck that you were a dick.
Well, then
there's that
you
too.
Suck.
No, there's sometimes sometimes, especially like with this, sometimes I could be a dick, like with potting and making sure
you're
everything's
not a
right.
Dick.
But But I don't give, like, I don't give a fuck. I said what I said. Shit gotta be right. It is what it is. Like,
cut,
I don't.
Cut.
I'm not a fucking, like, I'm not apologizing. I know what you're saying. But you're
not a dick. You're being authentic. Like, you're not being a straight up asshole. And some,
no, but sometimes you can be an asshole.
Well, you're not like fucking people. Everybody refers to me as an asshole because of the way I I'm just stern and because I hate the feelings and the bullshit and the gray areas.
I gotta tiptoe. I wanna be direct.
Fuck your feelings. I wanna get straight to the point.
So there's no confusion.
Yeah, people think I'm a dick in the way I speak. My family even thinks I'm a dick because I'm just straight to the point. I don't got time for the games. Mm-hmm. And another thing, the ego. The psychedelic I was talking about, they also call it the ego killer.
Mm-hmm.
It really literally kills your ego.
It
makes you realize nothing matters. All the shit that we think matters, nothing fucking matters.
It's incredible.
It resets you to where only what matters is what you think about. Everything else is just shed away.
Mm-hmm. One of my daily goals, and I make a year, like every day it's on my dry erase board, is it says kill your ego. Because that shit messes up so many things for us, man. And we literally let it, even myself, like I'm aware of it, but it's a work in progress, honestly. And your ego affects you so much that I'm like, I once heard somebody say, kill your ego. And I almost didn't understand what they meant, but I'm like, you gotta, all that shit that doesn't matter, shut that voice down that makes you think about that bullshit. Shut that noise and, you know, let all that you do come from your soul, from your heart, whatever, wherever it may be, but kill your ego.
That's exactly what this thing does. It's incredible. And it's just about not thinking you're anything special.
Now, where can we find this ego killer?
we'll talk off camera. You need shamans and stuff. It's official.
Camera?
We'll talk off camera. But I also wanted to talk about, you were talking about negative people.
Mm-hmm.
I cut those people off. But my mom, she sees everything in a negative way, but in a way where she worries too much.
Mm.
She always sees worst case scenario. Always worrying if we're going to get into a car accident or if we're sleeping enough, if we're drinking enough water.
That's a mom thing.
It's definitely a mom thing. Mm-hmm. So with her, with negative people, I cut them off because they're just not going to change. You could try to preach to these people and try to show them the light. They don't give a damn. They love complaining because that's just what it is. It's like the news. It's entertaining to people. It's negative stuff.
Yeah.
But my mom, I'm not going to cut my mom off.
No.
Been trying to help her as much as I can, just be more positive and realize there's the lighter side. There's the brighter side. Stop dwelling on the negative stuff. Stop worrying so much. We're adults. We're good because she just worries about her kids, me and my brother, my sister. So she's always worrying. I'm like, we're good. We're adults. You just got to worry less. You know, that's the best I could do. But
that's a good
topic
to talk about. I wish Yaya was here because she's a mom. Because it's like mom paranoia is a real thing. And it's from like when they're pregnant with you, they're already like consciously everything. They're focused on every decision I make is affecting my baby. And they carry that out. But then it's like when you're little and like there's outlets or there's sharp objects or there's the stove is on, they're constantly like on you. That's like a little PTSD, honestly. Because even when they're older, you're still thinking, my mom, till this day, I don't even live with her anymore. And she'll be like, I just worry about you. Like, I don't sleep at night thinking about, you didn't call me yesterday.
Mom,
you live alone.
In
what if someone broke in? What if someone did this to you? And it's like, I'm good. But we won't know until.
It's a part.
Did you feel that with your daughter though?
Feel what?
Paranoia in any way? Like, do you feel like you carry any of that?
No, I actually never felt that because she has good family on both sides.
Right.
So I always feel like she's fine. Mm-hmm. But with my mom, that's just like my main goal right now. Yeah. Just try to bring her as much peace as possible. So I literally my whole life since I was like a teenager till now, I just had to not tell her what I'm doing because she'll worry too much. That's one thing. I got to be very secretive.
On that note, kids, lie to your mom.
I don't be telling my mom everything, too, because it's like, you don't need to worry. I already know you're going to worry. Like,
about everything. I tell her, even if I tell her I'm going on a 24-hour fast, I would never tell her that.
No.
Oh, my God, you're going to die.
Yo, my mom,
are you
too.
Crazy? A Dominican mother?
We can do 7 days like that. Our bodies could do it no problem, but 24 hours, my mom
no
would
problem.
Think I'm crazy.
Crazy.
I'm crazy.
No problem. I have low blood sugar. I can't do that.
About 7 days and 7 hours, she's going down.
After like a couple, 3 hours, no food, I'm a fucking bitch.
Give this woman some sugar.
I need to eat. No, swear to God.
Yo, Ned is such a princess, bro. We're going to have an episode dedicated to her. And your majesty.
It's her show, bro.
It's her show.
Oh, every episode is dedicated
right,
to her.
It's my shit.
I'm starting to get
know
it now. This
place.
Is for her ego.
This is for my ego.
Kill it.
Yo, the way you kill your ego is really realizing that you're just one human on this earth. You're nothing spectacular.
Yes. Oh, that's another topic.
The thing is, you're
next
seeing everything from your point of view.
Mm-hmm.
the late great Mac Miller. I went to go see him live once doing an interview, man, in Brooklyn.
Rest in peace,
Mac. And he said thing I took away from the whole interview was he said everyone is Jesus in their own story.
Yeah.
Yes.
Ever since he said that, I'm like, yes, 100%. That's why you got to just let people be.
I had a cab driver who told me the opposite, and I took offense. What? And I took offense. Well, it was a similar thing, but he told me the opposite. He goes, Primo,
everyone is the devil in their own story.
No, not even. He was just like, I will never forget. I was drunk in the back, man. This is like New Year's, like 3 years ago. He was like, Primo, usted una mierda. And I'm like, what? And
he
was
translate like, for the English people.
Meaning he was pretty much like,
this is
shit. It's not the same, but yeah, he was like, you ain't shit pretty much. Like you're in the sense where it's like, you're here today, you're gone tomorrow, you ain't shit. And then he proceeded to say also.
And I
ain't
shit either. Continue. People will move
like,
on.
Yeah, and then he's like, yeah. We ain't shit. We all ain't shit in the sense where it's like, he further explained that it's like, we're flesh and blood, pile of bones. Like that's all we are. What we really are is what we experience, what we leave behind, who we touch, who we impact, all that good stuff. And then he's like, other than that, we're not as grand as people think us to be. Like everyone thinks that they are on, like you said, the Jesus, the main character in their story.
The main character.
It's like, bro, you're just here. Sometimes people have this obsession with finding a purpose. Sometimes your purpose might just be to experience. Sometimes your purpose might just be to live and be and leave behind, maybe. You know what I mean? Maybe help others with the things that you questioned and didn't understand.
You guys believe in the afterlife?
Yeah.
And you have to do good now to live good afterwards?
You have to do good. You have to have pure intentions. Yeah, good intentions. But I don't think your good intentions are always, they might hurt somebody. And in you doing good, you might still do harm to someone without realizing it.
But it affects your afterlife, how you live on Earth?
I don't think those moments affect your... Now, if I'm actively, like, killing people, raping people, murdering people, yes, I feel like that would affect me. I'm going to go to hell.
Vary because, as strange as it may sound, like, I mean, I grew up Catholic, right? I hate to bring religion into it because I don't like talking politics, religion, and gender, stuff like... All that complicated stuff, I'd rather just keep to my thoughts. But I grew up Catholic, so that's what I kind of... followed based on tradition. But honestly, I'm not too big on religion. Do I believe there's a higher power? Of course. But I think I just wake up every day and I try to be the best person that I can. Whatever religion exists, from what I've read, states that that's what you got to do. So I think I'm faring all right. At least I do my best. But in terms of afterlife stuff, I vary, man. It varies. Like sometimes I do, like sometimes things happen to me where I'm like, damn, could you have had a past life or what are we here? Not to have like a quarter life crisis, I guess, but
no, it's fine.
It's like, it's all like over the place. Sometimes I do believe there's an afterlife. Sometimes I do believe what you do here matters, where we go. Sometimes I believe we come right back here.
What do you believe right now?
Right now, dude, I feel like, and hear me out. I've had too many experiences. I feel like we come back differently until
reincarnation,
until we get what we're supposed to get. And then we can go.
So as soon as you die, you're in a not a born,
I don't
believe baby.
It. I don't know if it works that way, but I just feel like this isn't our first time here, I guess you could say. Like it's just a thought that came to me the other day. And I'm like, I feel like, yo, sometimes you experience things and you feel like you've seen things, know things, or lived through things. It's the weirdest thing ever that I get it. And
Do you believe in witches? Do you guys believe in witches?
What
do you mean? What is a witch?
Given our culture.
Let me give you a specific time. So I have a specific type of witch because there's different witches.
Wine opener after this.
Do you believe? Can we get a wine opener, Anthony, please? Please, thank you.
What is like a witch?
Okay,
though?
So the kind of witch I'm talking about, because it's going to lead to a story, she is like a medium, basically. So she sees dead, she talks to the dead, whatever. But she also reads tarot cards, she does like Ouija boards, things like that. So she's kind of with the afterlife thing. I heard her speak on a podcast. It's called Overheard LA. She was amazing. She has a podcast herself. So she tells a story of how she met with a woman who wanted to talk to her and get like some clarity about her past life. So she believes in reincarnation too. So she says that, well, the lady said when she, in a past life, when she did the reading for the lady, in a past life, this lady lost her baby to a fire. So in a past life, she was a woman who had a baby and lost the baby to a fire. Then she kind of was coming to the medium because she wanted to have kids. She wanted to be a mother, but she was so afraid of being a mother and she didn't know why. She's like, I don't know why I'm so afraid of being a mom, but I am. Like, I just feel this fear. I want you to give me clarity. So that's when she told her, okay, in a past life, you were a woman who lost your child. And when the lady went back to tell her mom, like, I went to see this witch and she told me in a past life I lost a baby to a fire and that's why now in this life I'm so afraid of having children. Her mom was like, that's so funny because when you were a little girl, you always took all of your baby dolls, you put them in the stroller and you put them at the front of the house by the door. Mm-hmm. And you would say, oh, in case there's a fire. She would say this as a little girl to her mom. And so the witch was basically saying that we always come back to life. We always come back to live again in order to fix a past trauma in our past life. So we come back to this world to heal whatever we went through in the past.
That's kind of like what I was saying. Like,
but
I
feel if
like,
you really have nothing to heal, you kind of just stay dead and you just like kind of just like your spirit is just kinda, like walking around, whatever.
That sounds like a movie thing though. It doesn't sound real.
You don't think it sounds real? That? I believe it.
You know why I say what I said and I understand the story?
It's that's just like a movie, a horror movie plot.
Things
that's
never
like
got,
fire things, movie. I'll watch. Yeah,
I'll write it sometime
yes,
in the future.
Yes, you should.
Those are, they exist.
And Francesco will be my producer because he's, well, I'm sorry, I write will.
Too.
You direct it.
I write
you
scripts
can yell
too.
At people.
Yeah, you can yell at people.
I direct and I write too.
Anthony's move. Nice.
I write scripts too.
Yeah, we'll do, it's greenhouse everything now. He thinks I'm kidding. We're going places. But I think, yo, weird shit have happened to me. Too weird to the point where it's like, there was a point where in my life, I'm like, all right, coincidence can only take you so far. And just strange things that just feel like out of this earth kind of stuff. Not
be as specific as you possibly could
dude,
be.
Dude, I have extreme deja vu, like ridiculously. You wouldn't believe it.
Man.
And I have dreams that are way
the
too
dreams
crazy.
Dreams are not real.
And then I'm like, and I've stop seen ghosts. And he's like, they're just an imagination, a figment of your imagination. I'm like, do I have to take this thing?
Yo, bro, no, but you're really going off of nothing.
It's stuff that essentially I am. I can't.
Do you believe what she said though about witches? Do you believe those witches?
I wouldn't brush it off.
You don't believe it. I don't believe none of that.
No. But I'm saying I wouldn't brush it off. Like, I'm not going to be like, you're crazy, Nat. I'll just be like,
oh, listen. Not her. What she said.
Oh, yeah. Even
the
person.
I believe in it. Yeah. I feel like, what do you believe?
You're Dominican, bro.
Do you believe in the afterlife?
You know what our culture.
You know.
Brujeria, all that shit.
I don't know what I believe right now because I never used to believe in none of that. And then since I started doing psychedelics and
that's
it's
what
like
I'm saying. Like someone who did psychedelics.
You can't fathom the idea, you know what I mean?
That's what I'm saying. Like anything really is possible.
But reincarnation, coming back because you didn't finish your past life duty. That's a movie. Nah, I don't believe none of that stuff.
I feel like it sounds very human
of us to do that.
My
reincarnation meets your reincarnation.
I read a beautiful book and it said something that sounded logical, where it's, we are, you know how you can only dream of what you know? You only dream of cars, houses, couches, people,
never heard that,
humans, cats, dogs. You never dream of stuff that's not imaginable to you because your dreams are only what your brain could
limit it to your imagination
and create.
That sounds like a movie.
So that's what your afterlife is, supposedly. Everything you've accumulated. So that's why religious people and even your grandma says, live a good life so I can see you in the afterlife, just so you could live a positive life so I can see you there too, because I'm going to be in a positive place. Mm-hmm. I'm going to always be around my family and my friends and my loved ones and my passions and my loves and my house and my dog and all the things I really cared about. So in the afterlife, that's what you're going to know. It's going to be a constant reel of what you lived. That's what
that's
that
a
book is. And I was like, that sounds pretty like realistic because that's what we are in our dreams. And death is a constant dream. So it kind of makes sense. We are what we know. Right. So that's why heaven and hell is how you live on earth. And if you live like a piece of shit, your afterlife's a piece of shit because that's what you're going to remember. But if you lived heaven on earth, which is an amazing life, you did good for yourself and people around you and your family.
Wouldn't
and your
that be
loved
subjective
ones.
Though, even? Because sometimes we're good, but we're not as good to other people who believe that they're good.
So then you're a piece of shit.
Not necessarily.
Oh, shit.
You ever met
either
like
good
a,
or bad? There's no
like,
really in between.
Like you ever like there are cynics and there are people who are fanatics. Like you those religious people that think that you and me ain't shit because we got tattoos.
That's a bad person.
You know what I mean?
That's not a good person.
Right, but to their standards, they're following the religion down pat.
Whatever.
So
they're gonna live a very judgy life in the afterlife.
So maybe it's not based off religion.
No, not religion at all.
So maybe it's
how our
neither
we are.
Of our theories are far fetched then because you don't really know.
We really 100%.
Don't know. 100% don't know. That was this time right. I read in the book and it just sounded right.
No. I get it because
a lot of times it all sounds great.
The logic and the spiritual for me clash a lot. That's why I said I'm in a very fickle like
yeah, yeah,
in terms
same.
Of that because I don't know. Like I just I get feelings sometimes and I'm just kind of like, I think this, but I would never state it as fact. I guess it's the feelings that I get. And sometimes some creepy shit be happening, man. I don't know.
Like, why are we different from a deer that gets hit on the road? Do they have a spirit? Do they have an afterlife? Where do their thoughts go? When they sleep, are they dreaming what they go through? Like, what is it? We could really just be an animal that dies and then we're done.
I feel like we can't drink together. Like, right.
For afterlife.
And that's the thing, too, because, like, as human beings, we're the only species that is able to, like, use language. Like, we use language and then we think about language and we think about, like, everything that we experience. We're able to put words to it. We have vocabulary for it. Animals don't. But that really adds, like, what really is the difference? It's just that. We're able to speak and communicate.
We can articulate everything.
Right? Yeah, that's
I definitely believe animals have spirits, bro.
Yeah, but animals feel emotions, too. They just don't. They communicate in other ways. So...
That's a whole other topic.
No, you can't.
This is a whole other, yeah. Nobody really knows.
Sorry. Back to the point.
Yes. What was the point? Because we just went...
Women
so
really don't give a fuck about women.
That was the other episode. Come on.
Bye.
I won't let that go, ever.
No, yeah, we really don't know, but...
Spirituality is deep. It's a deep topic.
It is.
Yeah. And we're going to get into more spiritual stuff.
Scared.
I'm so happy that you guys come here. This is
awesome. We're invited.
No, yes, I'm great. Yes. Is it becoming too much?
No.
It's too little.
It's too little. Yes. Yo. Twice a week.
Twice a week is crazy.
I would podcast as much as possible.
Oh, yeah, I love this.
With you guys, it flows very well, too. Mm-hmm. Somebody asked me, after a friend of mine heard the first episode, and they were like, oh, so you and your friends? And I was like, no, I met half of those people that day. Mm-hmm. She was like, yo, you guys flow very well. I said, thanks. We try.
My sister said the same thing.
A lot of paint.
Beer, too.
And, you know, beer.
And
yeah.
Beer. Angel, next time the hookah.
Yes. I've been waiting. I was just trying to, you know,
no,
dip
but you
my toes
work.
In the water.
Like, you're going to bring that to work and then bring here to life.
And though I need that little duffel bag.
Just store it away.
Like, what's in the duffel bag?
Mind all right, guys. That's all we have for this week. Thank you so much for watching, listening, wherever you listen, YouTube is the only place you can watch. Like, share, comment, subscribe, and we will see you next time. Bye.
Talk to us.
So you can't support something that's positive, something that's uplifting people, empowering people.